Certainly. Turn around, Candace. I'll miss you, Glenn. Okay, you have exam on Wednesday. You have no class on Wednesday. You have no discussion sections on Wednesday. You have time to prepare for the exam, which is at night, 8 to 10 p.m. in UTC. The classrooms were sent by email. Let me come around up here again for you. There's three different rooms because there's 240 of you. And it's in UTC 2.102A, 4.132, that's a point, and 4.134. And we're going to have chaperones and TAs and proctors keep track of you and all this activity disorder, different seats. We want to have a seat, every seat between each. So that's the exam date location. There are some of you who need to take the exam earlier in the day for a variety of reasons. Yes, Jeff?
Lost my mic again.
It says low battery again. Too bad. Do you have extra batteries by chance?
I can run and grab some.
Do you mind running and grab some? Just don't wander around much because the camera will be on man, is that right?
I'm sorry.
Do you want me to stay still since the camera will be on?
Oh, yeah, I guess.
Okay, I'll just try to bellow because we got a lot to cover today. I don't want to wait too long. Make sure the heads up. Hopefully we'll get the batteries resolved. There are five names I have of people who need to take the exam earlier that day. And I'm gonna write your names here. And if you need to take the exam earlier, like by need, not want, but you have a reason, like you have a conflict, then we can make arrangements. Five names. Is it Labib? How do you pronounce that name?
Yeah, that's right.
Labib? Okay, Labib and Jacqueline, Ricardo, Catherine, and Emily. We can set you up during the day. I don't know exactly when. It'll be something in the time frame of around noon to 3 p.m. so that you can take the exam that day because of a conflict or different needs you have where the exam at night doesn't work. And all five of you, if any of you have a problem with this, come talk to me right after class. I'll remove you from the list if you need to be removed from the list. If you need to be added to that list, today's the day to tell me. Come tell me after class. And we'll figure that out. And there's about five from Professor Hall's class as well. So about 10 of you nominally take an exam early that day. And we're going to swear you to secrecy and you can't tell your friends what was on the exam and all that kind of stuff. I don't know why you would, because that would just hurt your relative performance. But that's one thing we want to be sensitive to and cognizant of. All right, so the exam is this week, and I want to go through today, just review, and I want to go really quickly through the review, so we have time for Q&A, but we might not have time for Q&A, but I know there's office hours today, and tomorrow, and Wednesday, and I have office hours tomorrow, so hopefully you get a lot of support or additional clarifications you need from TAs or me or other people. I think I might pass this sheet. I'll probably send you this sheet, so don't feel like you have to write it. I'll send a PDF to Arkasama and Sam to send this sheet of paper to you that has this information. But here's what I want you to bring. I want you to bring yourself and a good attitude. I want you to bring a pencil or eraser or pencils and erasers and a calculator. You need to bring, well, you don't need to, but you are allowed to bring one 3-inch by 5-inch note card with handwritten notes on both sides. You cannot use a laser printer or a 6-point font to cram a bunch of stuff on there. You gotta be handwritten. And so those of you who have smaller handwriting, good for you, you now win. But you suffer the rest of your life because no one can read what you're doing. But for this, it'll be to your benefit. So you bring one note card, and as I told you before, for the second exam, you'll have a second note card. For the third exam, you'll have a third note card. So it's not open notes, open book, it's open note card. Thank you very much. See if I can figure out how to do the battery things. Okay, I guess that, is that working better now in the back? Okay, thanks. So that's what you need to bring. You don't need to bring scratch paper. We'll provide enough room in the exam for you to do your work on the exam itself. Then for approach, I'm gonna walk through this one by one with you. Be very clear with your solutions. one of those things that people don't realize until they're a grader or they're a TA, but if something's really hard for you to grade, it's hard to grade it. And if it's hard to grade, it puts you in a position where you're kind of grumpy. And it's like hard to find where a solution is, it's hard to find the rational logic where you got there. That does not help you. You want to be very clear about what you're doing and how you got there. The clearer you are, the neater you write, the more linear it is. It's randomly around the page, that doesn't help you. When you go in order, have a sequence to it, that will help you. So be very clear with what you're doing and how you're doing it. Even if you get it wrong, if you're really clear and your logic is pretty good, your thought process is good, you'll probably still get a lot of partial credit. This is a partial credit exam. This is only 4 problems. And so you're gonna live and die by partial credit. The clearer you are, the better you'll do in the partial credit sweepstakes. Draw your system with clear boundaries. Draw the system, win a problem. Like some questions, like if it's a vocabulary question, you may draw it, but sometimes you might need to. But look for an excuse to draw your system and with clear boundaries. Draw your process diagrams as appropriate. We're gonna talk about process diagrams today, like PV diagrams, TV diagrams, that kind of thing. Note what's given. Note your simplifying assumptions, that's key. Because your assumptions are an important part of the thought process we're looking for. Do you know what assumptions are reasonable to make in this case? And so note them. It also will help reveal the logic of your thought process for the solution. If you have the wrong assumption, but everything else right, like, oh, they would have got it right had they not used the wrong assumption. So it helps us give you contemplation for partial credit. Note your governing relations, like the Odo-Gas law or the first law or whatever it is, your relations you're using. Use symbols as far as possible. One of the temptations engineers have is we're numerate people. We love numbers. Engineers want to put numbers in as early as possible, and you really should need to do that. You need not to do that. You need not to put your numbers in early. Set it up symbolically as far as you can. Take the algebra and in calculus as far as you can. Then insert numbers as the last step. If you set up all the problems perfectly correctly, but just didn't fill in numbers, you should still do fine on the exam. The numbers are a part of the grading. We're looking for you the right answer, but we're looking for the right thinking. And that is shown symbolically better than with numbers. Interpolate where necessary, even by eye if you need. I'm gonna give a quick example or explanation of interpolation today. You haven't had to do that in the tables a lot because of automatic tables. You're not gonna have those automatic tables exams. You're gonna have to interpolate. And you know what? If you crunch for time, eyeball it. But I'd rather you do it for real. So it's worth more if you do it for real, but if you're real crunch, you can eyeball it to show that you're thinking along those lines. Be careful with relative versus absolute temperatures. That's a classic mistake. Be careful with your units. That's a classic mistake. Read your keywords carefully, like rigid container. Well insulated. A rigid container means it's constant volume. Well insulated usually means no heat transfer. And pay attention to what those words are meaning. Those words are there for a reason. They're clues for information. For your preparation, fold this down. And we'll get this out to you as a PDF. For your preparation, make a nice note card. Really invest in organizing your thoughts. The process of preparing the note card is more useful than the note card, in my opinion. If you really put some thought into designing it well, then you will be helped in your preparation for the exam. There's a classic sitcom from the 80s called Growing Pains, and it won't mean anything to a lot of you, but there's a guy in there, an actor, who is gonna cheat on an exam. So he writes all the answers for his history exam on his tennis shoes, and he goes in to cheat. In the exam. It does really well, but he finds that he doesn't need to cheat because the process of writing it all down in his shoes, he memorized it. So he aced the exam, and then celebrating how he aced it, he put his shoes up on the table, and the professor sees all the answers on his shoes, and he gets in trouble for cheating, but he's like, I didn't cheat. I meant to cheat. I wanted to cheat, but in the process of preparing to cheat, I didn't have to cheat. So this is your chance to prepare with your note card to cheat, and then you won't need it because you'll understand it because you wrote it down. Does that make sense? Don't write it on your shoes or your hat brim. That's a good one. The hat brim, that's a good one. So don't do that out there. Practice problems. You should practice. Oh, it's off the sheet. Sorry. Practice problems. Practice problems. Practice problems. Man, this is a problem-solving class. Solve problems. There are a lot of examples with solutions in the book. Someone asked about getting you numeric answers for the other chapter questions, and we haven't done that, and I might not be able to do that. But I would do as many problems as you can find, and really look at the solution to really try to figure it out on your own. And if you need to look at the solution and then put it down and solve it yourself, hey, that's fine. But it's not helpful to look at the solution and write it down on your paper. Like, look at it, go, oh, okay, now I get it, and then go do it yourself. And the next time, maybe you don't need to look at the solution until you're done, and then you check. So use the solutions as a crutch, as a teaching tool, but you're not going to have them available for the exam, obviously. I think you should sleep the night before, and I don't think you should experiment with crazy foods and fasting or anything else like that. So a lot of students think, oh, I don't feel prepared. I'm going to stay up late studying extra hard. And there's a point where that doesn't work to your favor anymore, that the extra staying up late actually works against you because you're not sharp the next day, especially for a nighttime exam. So I think you should study the night before, maybe push it a little bit, but don't stay up all night studying. You need to sleep. Sleep's pretty important. And I was saying that 7:30 p.m. is not the time to experiment with a brand new type of cuisine or lots of caffeine before the exam. So I think that I would think about what's in your body and whether you're sharp and feeling good for the exam. Because if you're not feeling good, then that probably won't play to your favor. Review of topics, I'll go over this in class right now. Think about perfect gases versus ideal gases versus real gases. Think about properties, energy balance for closed systems. So this is the thing. I told you to be scope one through chapters one through three, but then we sent an email a couple days ago saying actually we're gonna include 4.1 as part of the scope. So it's chapter three with the next section, which is the energy balance, the first law of thermodynamics for closed systems. So the scope's creeped ahead a little bit into this exam, so we have different things we can test you on exam two. Make sure you're ready for that. Know the difference between internal energy and enthalpy and the relationships for them. I'll talk about that a little bit today. Make sure you can do some basic interpolation by hand, even if you have to do it by eye. This is important for saturation domes or the vapor domes, where you have quality and other factors where you're partway across the dome from left to right, from liquid to vapor, and you need to interpolate. Make sure you know your PV and TV diagrams with isobars and isotherms and that kind of thing, and know your unit systems. You don't need to write this all down, we'll send you this piece of paper. That's what we're going to go over in class right now. So, know all those things. Maybe I can zoom out and show you this whole page at once. Will that balance? Okay, I can keep it up there if you want. All right. Let's go through a review of things I think you need to know. Has a test been made? Yes.
Yeah. And you.
And I know what it is. Yeah, and I know the answers too. But the TAs don't. And that's on purpose. So that when you go by office hours, you won't be like, you're elbowing them for that kind of stuff. Although, not that they would care. They don't really like you that much. I'm just kidding. They think you're adorable. So the exam's been made. It has not been printed. We might fiddle with it a little bit here and there, but it's mostly. All right. You want to know chapters 1 through 4.1. I'm going to go a little bit to chapter 4. That's the first law for closed systems, not open systems. The last couple lectures on the open systems, steady flow, steady state, it's not a part of that. It's the first law for closed systems. I want you to know the units. You need to be facile for both unit systems. So know both unit systems. There's actually many unit systems, but we only care about two in this class, which is SI and the U.S. Standard Conventional System, or English units. And this can be goofy for pounds, mass, and pounds force, and BTU, that kind of thing, because it's just not as natural or intuitive as the SI unit. So make sure you're facile with that, you're familiar with it. We have some relationships you need to know. Work equals force times distance. Then there's specific properties. Specific volume is volume over mass. Specific internal energy is internal energy over mass. Specific enthalpy is total enthalpy over unit mass. So those are the specific properties. You need to know those. You know P gauge, the gauge pressure, versus absolute pressure, versus atmospheric pressure. Those are units called these relations. You know that for temperatures in Kelvin equals temperatures in degrees Celsius. Plus 273.15 degrees. Oh, this reminds me. I'll be providing the tables for you. I'm gonna print. I have a printout of tables, so you have hard copies version of the tables. And if there are constants you need, the constants will be on the handouts or sheets as well. So you don't need to provide that. Although, if you're not sure, like I'm not gonna put relationships on there. I'm not gonna put relationships, but constants. Like, I don't expect you to memorize R for every species and that kind of thing. So we'll provide the tables. Now, Packer Hall's class he told them, bring your own tables. Which is fine, these different book, different tables. So we'll have handouts for you, but only grab it if you're in our class, and you shouldn't be in here if you're not in our class, so that should be okay, but we'll try to keep an eye out for that. So all students aren't ticket tables, only Weber students are.
So be able to go between Fahrenheit and Rankine.
And between Celsius and Kelvin. You need to know your systems and the types of systems. There are isolated systems. There are closed systems. And there are open systems. Isolated means there's no interaction with the outside. There's no energy or mass transfer or exchange. A closed system has energy exchange but not mass exchange. And an open system has energy and mass exchange. You should know those. You should think about properties and constraints from processes. So process, properties, or constraints. And this means things like, this marker's almost dead. Can you still read the writing? Can you read it in the back? Okay. Things like adiabatic, isobaric, isometric, isothermal, polytropic. You should know what that means. You should have a concept of what energy is. None of us really know what energy is, but have some concept of what it is. And we can think of energy as like potential energy, kinetic energy, internal energy. Potential energy is based on a relative reference on height and the gravitational potential. Kinetic energy is based on speed, velocity, the motion. Use internal energy based on chemical composition and action, based on chemical bonds, vibrations, rotations, translation, that kind of thing. I want you to be savvy on energy transfer. Energy transfer happens in a variety of ways. It happens by work, by heat transfer, and by mass transport. And it goes by mass transport, that's usually H, that's where enthalpy becomes important. Heat transfer is Q, and work as shaft work, a rotating shaft, for example, in a turbo generator kit, or by boundary work. Boundary work is PdV work. Work from 1 to 2 is the integral from 1 to PdV. So you really should know PdV work. We spent a lot of time on that earlier on. And by the way, a little work, 1 to 2, is the integral from 1 to 2 of Pd little v. For specific work versus with specific volume. If it's positive, and work is done by system on surroundings. So if positive work done by system on surroundings. If negative, work is done by surroundings on the system. Look at that PdV term. If the work is done by the surrounding on the system, it's being compressed. If it's getting compressed, the volume is getting smaller. If the volume is getting smaller, then dV is negative. The change of volume is negative because the second volume is smaller than the first volume. So the net integral, that will be negative. So if the work's done by the surroundings on the system, it's going to be a negative work. If you look at the work done by the system surroundings, like the, you're expanding a balloon, which is doing work, pressing out the atmosphere out of the way, the volume's expanding, that's going to be a positive work. is if you want to find the work, the size of people define it as a negative PDV, or to make up for that negative sign, if you want to find the work, and you want it to be a positive number, you can also apply another negative. Keep track of these signs and draw your arrows the right way and think about which ways the volumes are actually changing. This P is not always constant. Maybe I'll write that here. For PDV work, P is not always constant. And that becomes important because that affects your interval. If P is not constant, if P is constant, it's an easy interval. If P comes out front, you integrate P. If the P is not constant, you have to think about it a little bit more. You can also calculate area under the PV diagram. We get the integral of PDV, but that's the same as the area under the curve. You can numerically calculate it. Do not use PDV work or the integral of PDV to find shaft work. Shaft work has a different rotational inertia, it's a different kind of thing. I know I'm going fast, but I'm hoping to leave some time for questions. You know the ideal gas law. And that's like PV equals MRT, or P little v equals RT, and those are absolute temperatures. That's a typical place to make errors, use the wrong temperature for your ideal gas law. It is not for liquids, solids, mixtures, or real, say non-ideal, gases. Ideal gases are those that operate in a way according to the ideal gas law. But basically it means low pressure gases where they act like billiard balls, the way they bump off each other, they're not feeling the presence of the other. And I'll come back around in just a couple minutes to what a real gas is and compressibility and all that, so I'll come back to that. You need to know about properties. And a couple things about properties you need to know. One is you need two independent properties to define the thermodynamic state. You also need to know that P and T are not independent under the saturation dome. So if you know that it's saturated and you know the temperature, well then you know the pressure automatically. Because if it's saturated and you know the temperature, well, that temperature is the saturation temperature, and the pressure is the saturation pressure that accompanies that temperature. They're not independent underneath the saturation dome. There are two ways to get properties. Anybody remember what they are?
Tables.
Tables. A good one. That's one of them. People often forget, oh yeah, it's in the tables. What else?
Equations of state.
EOS. Equations of state. There's two ways to get your properties. Because sometimes students come in and I tell them again, like, I can't find the equation of state for this. Like, I might be able to complicate it. Is it in the tables? Like, oh, I could have gone to the tables like 3 hours ago. I'm banging my head against the wall on this. So sometimes check the tables to see if it's got the answer for you. That might spare you a lot of effort. If not, then you gotta go figure out the right equation of state to use. Okay, you need to know process diagrams.
and TB, PV are the typical ones. There's also TS, which we'll get to when we learn the second law. S is entropy. So the TS diagram is interesting later on. There's also HV or pH. There's a variety of diagrams. So TV, PV, what we've done so far. You need to know where the dome is, what the dome looks like, the saturation dome there. And you need to know what the isobars are. For a TV diagram, the isobars come up, straight across, up, over, across, and up. You just got to know this. And those are isobars. You also need to know which way the pressure is going. And this is the critical point. And you have subcooled liquids on the left and superheated vapor on the right. And you have a saturated liquid line on the left of the dome. You have a saturated vapor line on the right of the dome. It's a mixture underneath the dome. And as you're expanding the volume and adding temperature, you're raising the pressure as well. You have a PV diagram, and you know where the isotherms are, which goes up and to the left. Those are isotherms. You're increasing temperature at your critical point, same kind of stuff. You just got to know those. And even best if it makes intuitive sense and you fully understand it. You kind of talk yourself into this. Why is pressure, you add temperature, you're adding heat to boiling water, but it's a constant pressure. The temperature goes up for boiling water until it starts boiling. And then when it's all vapor again, it starts increasing in temperature again. So you could think of why that might be. Or you have a constant temperature system here that you're compressing. As you compress your system, the gas phase, you're making the volume smaller. As you compress it, then it drops in liquid form, the finite liquid form, and then the pressure goes up again, and the temperature goes up again. Okay, so there's a variety of things, a variety of ways you can think about it. But if not, memorize it. It's not intuitive. When you're in the dome, you need to know how to navigate your way around it. So you have your dome. This is temperature or pressure. This is your dome. And you have your subcooled liquid on over to the left, your critical points. You want to think about your quality. Quality tells you how far over you are. X is quality. Tells you how much is a vapor phase. It's the mass of the system you're looking at. In the vapor phase over the mass total, which is the mass of the vapor phase over the mass of liquid plus the mass of vapor. It tells you, that's an L, not an E. It tells you if it's high quality that most of your mass is in the vapor form. If it's low quality, most of it's in liquid form, saturated liquid. Your volume is 1 minus X times the liquid volume plus X times the vapor volume. Same kind of thing for you. And H. If it's a compressed liquid, then that means the pressure is greater than the saturation pressure. So if it's saturated and you keep increasing pressure, you're squeezing more of the vapor into the liquid. Or if it's a subcooled liquid, that means the temperature is less than desaturation. It's like if you cool things out, they'll liquefy eventually. That's why we get dew point. That's why we get water on our lawns. So it's cool over the evening. This water vapor in the air, it cools out, becomes a subcooled liquid and drops out onto your grass. You have an incompressible liquid approximation. And that is your volume of your compressor liquid as a function of pressure and temperature. Metro gamma Vs is just a VL at T set. Your internal energy of the compressed liquid as a function of pressure and temperature is just UL for T set. Entropy, which we'll learn, you don't need that this time. It's just the liquid edge of the dome, but it gets funky for the enthalpy, because enthalpy is U plus PV. So for an incompressible liquid approximation, you can use the liquid edge of the dome properties for that particular temperature. But for enthalpy, the pressure and temperature will matter in this term. Should I go this fast every class? Kind of fast. More fun that way. Can't write a bunch of stuff and leave. Interpolation. You can do that. The interpolation is important for finding the quality. You're interpolating between the VL and VV to find your actual T set. And you have to interpolate one property to the other to find X. And you can use similar triangles. So use similar triangles, which means it is a linear interpolation. There are actually fancier interpolation techniques you might get to someday. You can have polynomial interpolations and spline interpolations, but we'll just use linear interpolation. And the idea is that you have some property, Y versus X. Don't confuse this actually with quality, other trivia. And you have some relation from point to point. It's X1. And the other end is X2. Corresponds to Y1 and Y2. And you want to interpolate to the middle or someplace to find what X is. And that corresponds to some Y. Well, there's similar triangles. You can use these ratios of the totals to find what is in between. Xi, we'll call this Xi and Yi. Xi minus X1 over Yi minus Y1, and these are similar triangles, is the same ratio as X2 minus X1 over Y2 minus Y1. Because it's linear. The relationships between the delta Y for the whole thing and delta X and the small delta Y and small delta X are the same. And then you can manipulate that. You get Xi minus X1 over X2 minus X1 equals Yi minus Y1 over Y2 minus Y1. It's just a proportion. What proportion of the distance from left to right or from bottom to top are you going for your interpolation? That's a single, simple, linear interpolation. And get familiar with that for the tests. If you guys all eyeball like, oh, I'm 40% along the way there, you can do a more precise calculation as well. The more precise, the better, but if you don't have time, you know, just do what you can. And I know some of you have been by to see the TAs about that, so I know they've been talking to you about it as well. There's also some great Wikipedia pages, how to interpolate. I'll show you how to do it. You have to do it for thermodynamics every once in a while. It's not really what we're testing for, but it's a necessary evil. Let's talk about perfect versus ideal versus real gases. A perfect gas, I think I defined this before. Perfect gas is an ideal gas with constant specific heats. An ideal gas follows PV equals RT, and molecules act like billiard balls, which means they collide and bounce off each other. They don't interact with each other beyond that. Thank you. It's usually low pressure.
That means the low pressure, they're spread out so that they don't bump into each other too much. At really high pressure, if they get too close, they're no longer ideal.
And specific heats might or might not be constant. So if it's monatomic, argon or neon, that kind of thing, then constant specific heats are relevant. If it's polyatomic, then you have non-constant specific heats. And then I'll say unless the change in temperature is small, and I mean small, pretty small, 5 degrees, 10 degrees. But if it's hundreds of degrees, probably you can't assume it's constant unless you're really stuck. For a real gas, it follows the ratio of PV equals ZRT. Then you can find Z from the compressibility chart. You do not need to put the compressibility chart on your note card, could you imagine? If you need it, we'll provide it, but know how to use it. You get that Z from compressibility chart. And you use PR, which is the pressure over the critical pressure, and TR, which is the temperature of the critical temperature, to find Z. And by the way, the critical values are in table 2. The ratios?
Yeah.
Thank you. You find Z from PR and TR, where PR equals the pressure over the critical pressure, and TR equals the temperature over the critical temperature. That's a comma between the two. Be familiar with the concept of specific heats. Specific heat tells you for a property the rate at which energy changes, the amount of energy change you need to cause a temperature change. For ideal gases, the U of an ideal gas is only a function of temperature, and the enthalpy of an ideal gas is only a function of temperature. And you have these relationships where dU equals CV dT, and dH equals CP dT. U2 minus U1, these changes are usually important, is the integral CV dT, and H2 minus H1 is the integral of CP dT. And that CV or CP might not be constant, so you might have to integrate that. Oh, this one's dying too. CP minus CV equals R, equals R bar over M. And CP equals 5 halves R, and CV equals 3 halves R for monatomic gases.
If it's a real gas, it'll depend on something other than temperature.
Well. Yeah, if it's a real gas, it might still be heavily temperature dependent, but there might be other factors. usually temperature is the key factor, but for ideal gases, it's easier to say, oh, it's just temperature that drives it. Composition and other factors will affect it as well. Switch to the blue, we'll see how this goes.
Finding CP, you can do that by using the tables. You can use integrals with polynomial expressions.
You had a lot of homework on that.
And you can also use CP mean, or an average CP, at constant pressure, but the top two are better than using an average or mean CP. You really want to use the tables, which are more precise, or the integrals. So it says CP mean at constant P, you know, by a billion new markers. The first law for a closed system. The energy of the system at the end, or the final, is equal to what you started with plus what you added to it, minus what you took out of it, which means the change in energy for a system equals what you added minus what you took out of it. So EF minus EI could be like E2 minus E1, like the state 2 energy minus the state 1 energy. And that is the change and energy for the system. And then you have over here, En equals Qn plus work in, and E out equals Q out plus work out. Now, for an open system, you'd also have mass transport bringing enthalpy in with it, but this is for a closed system, so we don't have those mass terms. So you have your expressions for how energy changed for the system based on where you started, where you ended, what you added, what you took out of it, and there's a Q and W terms coming in and out of it. Like a piston cylinder system, which is closed, but the mass isn't moving around, but the piston's changing, that might be doing boundary work. You might have heat coming in or out of it. You can do first law energy balance on F to figure it out. Give like 2 minutes. Any questions in 2 minutes? Yeah,
right here. Should we focus on any vocab words at all, or is it going to be all problem solving?
I think it'll be mostly problem solving. Definitely, I pay attention to vocab as well. I like vocab, I test them, which test.
Okay,
so I'm going to be sure you understand what the terms mean and when they're appropriate and that kind of thing. Yeah, question in the back?
You have to know all the equations. You didn't really do that in class at homework.
Like Van der Waals and all that?
Yeah.
No, I'm not really looking for that. I mean, I have no ideal gas law, so make sure you know that one. Make sure you understand polytropic and some of those. But you don't need to know some of the more peculiar equations of state. Question back here? Pistons are often isobaric. They don't have to be isobaric. Like you could have a piston going against a spring or something where the pressure is changing. But if it's a piston with a fixed weight and a fixed pressure outside of it, then it's probably isobaric. If you have combustion inside the piston where the gas getting hotter is increasing the pressure, that's going to be changing. So it's not necessarily isobaric, although it's usually isobaric. One more question, then we'll stop. Yes?
How fluid is EF1?